The time is August 991. There are rumors of a potential Viking raid headed for the coast of Essex, England. Near the River Blackwater sits a town called Maldon, a very vulnerable town that would be perfect for a Viking raid. In response of the rumors, Lord Byrhtnoth, Earl of Essex, assembles an army of inexperienced farmers and laborers, also known as the Fyrd. Along with the levy of Fyrd marched his comitatus, a small group of veteran warriors that were only loyal to Lord Byrhtnoth. Soon after, news of a recent landing of Scandinavian raiders was reported on the nearby Northey Island. Their army was 2,000 to 4,000 strong, and their fleet consisted of about 93 Viking ships. Some sources say that they were led by a man named Olaf Tryggvason. The rumor was confirmed true. Earl Byrhtnoth marshaled his forces near the estuary of Blackwater. He told them what positions they must keep and ordered them to hold their shields with steady hands and to show no fear in the face of the enemy. But the Vikings were not here for conquest, they were here for gold. This conflict does not have to end with a clash of spears. So the Vikings sent forward this message to Lord Byrhtnoth and his Anglo-Saxon army. And I quote from the poem, The Battle of Maldon. I send to you from the bold seamen a command to tell that you must quickly send treasure to us, and it would be better to you if with tribute buy off this conflict of spears than with us bitter battle share. No need to slaughter each other if you be generous with us. We would be willing for gold to bring a truce. Battle could have been avoided with a single tribute of gold, but Earl Byrhtnoth had a different kind of tribute in mind. He replied to their message with this response. To us, it would be shameful that you with your coin to your ships should get away without a fight. Now you thus far into our homeland have come. You shall not so easily carry off our treasure. With us must spear and blade first decide the terms. Fierce conflict is the tribute we will hand over. It was clear to both parties that this was only going to be settled through violence. Northey Island was connected to the mainland by a narrow land bridge that could only be used when the tide went out. This is where the Earl of Essex plans to meet their enemy. And so the Vikings started to cross. Fortunately for the Anglo-Saxon army, they could only march a few men at a time, and when they did, they were hit hard by a storm of arrows. After some skirmishing, battle was met. Fierce fighting took place, but the Anglo-Saxon defense was too strong. Out of frustration, the Vikings withdrew from battle, and negotiations began. Olaf wanted a fair fight. He requested safe passage across the causeway and a proper time to set up his army for a line battle. After a short time of analyzing the situation, Earl Byrhtnoth accepted his request, and the Scandinavian raiders safely crossed the causeway and formed their battle line. There were two possible reasons why he accepted the Vikings' request. The first reason is that the Norsemen could easily get back into their ships, sail down the coastline, and attack an undefended position. The second is honor. There was no victory without honor. This was really important in Anglo-Saxon culture. It was known as Ofamode. This literally translates to over spirit, and the Earl of Essex was not going to take victory without a fair fight. And so the armies were ready to meet in battle. And so they did. Both sides charged, shields clashed, swords and axes sliced through limbs. The battlefield was stained red. It was a brutal fight, but ended as soon as it started. Lord Byrhtnoth was hit by a poisoned spear and was slain on the battlefield. Soon after, his inexperienced soldiers broke. Even some of his chosen warband abandoned his side. But a small number of brave warriors fought over his dead body in vain. The Anglo-Saxon army was utterly defeated. Soon after the battle, King Athelred the Unready paid off the Vikings with 10,000 Roman pounds, about 3,300 kilograms of silver. This was the first example of Danegeld, a tax to raise money to pay tribute to Viking raiders, and in return, they wouldn't plunder their lands. Byrhtnoth's headless body was buried in the cathedral at Ely. And more recently, a statue of Lord Byrhtnoth looks over the battlefield of Maldon, a symbol of honor, courage, and bravery. But we have gone back in time. Lord Byrhtnoth is alive and well. His troops are ready to fight. Will he change history, or will history repeat itself? Welcome to the Battle of Maldon. Hello, hello, what's up guys? It's Pixelated to follow and welcome to the Battle of Maldon 991. This, of course, is a custom battle scenario for Medieval 2 Total War, the Britannia expansion. Now, I know technically Medieval 2 starts on the year 1066, so this time period is a little bit after the Battle of Maldon, but it's still going to give you a good idea what happened during the battle. And we get to watch firsthand the epic struggle between the Anglo-Saxon English and the Scandinavian raiders. So let's go ahead and look at the army comps. We'll start with the Anglo-Saxons, which is represented by the English, England here. He's got 8 units of levy spearmen. That's a lot of spears. That represents his inexperienced force of farmers and laborers, and 6 units of peasants. So he's got 4 in this flank, and then 4 on this flank, so 2 different flanks there. In the center is the comitatus, the elite warband that is loyal to Lord Byrhtnoth. He's got 4 units of armored sergeants. They look pretty heavily upgraded. And in the center, representing the general's bodyguard, is a unit of dismounted feudal knights. Now, of course, they didn't have feudal knights in this time period. This is just simply to represent the elite skill of these bodyguards. And he has 1 unit of peasant archers. So that's the Anglo-Saxon force. It looks like they're marching towards the little land bridge here. And the way the scenario works is that the Vikings get reinforcements on the flank here after 10 minutes. It represents the ships that sail down the coastline and drop off troops. So you have 2 options if you're commanding the Anglo-Saxon English. You can try to hold right here and fight off the enemy, or you can let him cross. You can give him access, let him cross, and let him line up, and you fight. And of course, if you let him cross, he gets the reinforcements right away. But let's go ahead and look at the Scandinavian force that's represented by Norway here. It's mostly a force of Viking raiders and dismounted huskarls. There they are, pretty elite. And there's the general, Olaf. Hello, Lord Olaf. And he has 1 unit of Norse archers. And then the reinforcements that he gets 10 minutes later, I believe it's like 2 units, maybe 3 units on each. Yeah, I think 3 units of Viking raiders here, and then 3 units of Viking raiders over here. So let's go ahead and do normal speed. And remember guys, they're not reenacting the battle. They're trying to change the battle. They're gonna try to maybe get a different outcome. So maybe Lord Byrhtnoth will take victory here and the Vikings will not take their gold. But right now he is charging forward, and I believe he's not going to let him cross. I think he's going to go, well actually you know what, he's stopping right here, so maybe, just maybe, he's going to let him cross the land bridge and do a fair fight. Come on Lord Byrhtnoth, learn from the first time, don't let him cross, hold. And here we go, we've got the Vikings crossing the land bridge. And this was, of course, a scenario built by Paladin Bob. By the way, the players here, leading the Anglo-Saxon English, we have Paladin Bob, who's leading them. And leading the Vikings, we have Emperor Alan. So I just want to give a shout out to those guys for playing this battle and giving me the battle replay. I'm really excited to see what happens here. It's so cool, even though the units here are very early period, you got a lot of peasants, you've got a lot of levy spearmen, but the fact that this is historical makes it feel so much cooler. Like, I'm watching a battle that really happened in real life. It's pretty amazing, and with Total War, you can do stuff like that. But now we have Paladin Bob pushing forward his peasant archers, and I think he's going to try to get some early harass off, but we also have the Vikings pushing forward their Norse archers. So we might have a little bit of a skirmish battle here. So, man, I don't know. Like, the odds for the Anglo-Saxon English are not looking pretty good. But if you look at the balance of power, that red bar represents the Anglo-Saxon English, and it's in their favor. So it could be because they have a lot of troops that are kind of, I don't know, they're kind of useless. But maybe because they have a lot of them, it kind of swings the favor of the battle in his way. So we'll see what happens. But right now, both sides are pushing forward. We're going to fast forward a little bit and see what happens here. Now remember, he only has 10 minutes. Because he denied access across the land bridge here, he has only 10 minutes before the reinforcements show up. Which again represents the Viking flank there. You know, if they flanked their ships over and dropped off troops. But here we go. The skirmish battle has begun. And the peasant archers are firing down on the Vikings. Pretty epic start to this battle. It's so far, it's starting just like the real battle, which is pretty cool. And I think the Vikings are going to let this skirmish continue on. He's not going to push forward his Viking raiders. But look at this map here. Look at the ships in the background. This is great. So I just want to give a pat on the back to Paladin Bob for making such an awesome map here. That, you know, it doesn't exactly perfectly represent the Battle of Maldon, but for a video game and its limitations, this is the best it's going to get, and this is pretty awesome. It feels like we're here in Essex, England. Brave Anglo-Saxons fighting for their homeland. Back, you beast. Go back. You will not take our gold. Alright, so the skirmish kind of dies there. And now Paladin Bob is pushing forward his levy spearmen. So the battle doesn't exactly start off super fast here. So we're going to fast forward a little bit. Watch him get his spears in position. It looks like actually he's going to charge. He's got them in loose formation. Yes, guys, I believe the infantry fight is about to begin right on this choke point. The edge, the very end of this land bridge. And of course, it's another stormy day in England. Nothing new there. Here we go, guys. Collision of Viking raiders into the levy spearmen. And so the battle has begun. The Battle of Maldon. And now we've got more Viking raiders charging in. Ooh, he needs to send in more infantry. He needs more support over there. One unit of levy spearmen is not going to hold against two units of Viking raiders. Look at that. Look at all the dead levy spearmen. They're having a tough time. And remember, guys, the clock is ticking. He only has 10 minutes where he can hold. He's got his Vikings. He's got his peasant archers over here firing down, trying to weaken their numbers. And here we go. Here comes some more support. Some levy spearmen that are about to join in, help their brothers here that are already engaged in melee. Oh, yes. And more Viking raiders coming crashing down. So both armies wanting to claim the land bridge. The Vikings desperately wanting to cross. But these levy spears, I don't know. I almost feel like you gotta put them in the Sheltron formation. You know, they would like last a little longer and you would give time to your archers to fire down at the enemy. But now he's sending in even more levy spears. So far, it's been just like the battle, guys. A small little skirmish near the little opening of this land bridge. But he's running out of time. That flanking force is going to move soon. I'm going to keep my eye out on that flanking Viking force. Oh man, pretty epic skirmish battle here between the archers. Both armies only bringing one unit of Norse archers. I think even size-wise, like, the size of the armies are, I mean, of course they were bigger, but, like, they feel pretty close to accurate, you know? Like, they didn't have massive armies back then because it was more of war bands, small groups of elite soldiers that were loyal to their lord or their chieftain, whoever led the war band. And it was also considered the highest honor to die next to your lord during a battle. And the archers, look at this, the archers are now engaged in melee. So he's sending in his archers. And I'm actually quite impressed by the levy spears that they're still fighting. I guess because there's so many of them, but look how many have died. It's mostly English here. The Scandinavian forces are just ripping through them. And now he's using fire arrow. That is a good idea, because fire arrow will break forces. Look at that, automatically breaking those peasant archers. Plus they're engaged in melee, which you shouldn't do with archers. But yeah, the fire arrows are going to crush them. Crush their morale. But it's still not 10 minutes yet. Look at this. This is awesome. Got the ships in the background. A great fight. A very awesome fight. Pretty long battle too. Like I said earlier, I'm really, really surprised by how long the levy spears are fighting here. Get some nice close-ups of this intense action. Look at this. Look at this big blob. Form shield wall. Not exactly the best shield wall here. But of course, you know, it is a game. There's limitations to games. But it would be pretty intense to watch two shield walls just collide. So we're about halfway through the battle and it's still pretty much dead even. The advantage is still slightly in favor of the English. And the peasants are now breaking. Officially they're breaking. And check this out, guys. I believe... Nope, the reinforcements are not here yet. Okay. I thought I saw him moving. But he's going to go ahead and retreat. He's giving up the position here. So Lord Byrhtnoth retreating his men. And ooh, some of his levy spears break from the fight. So he's got a couple units breaking. And yeah, he's going to go ahead and retreat back up this way. So we'll go back, fast forward, let them get in position. And yes, the reinforcements here, the flanking forces are now able to move because I guess he's allowing them to cross. I guess they had an agreement exactly like the historical battle. They agreed, let them cross, and he's going to form up here. And he's also going to get access to the reinforcements. So the armies are setting up for the final push. Oh man, will history change? Or will Lord Byrhtnoth take this victory? Oh man, I don't know. I kind of worry about his army. Like he needs to charge in he's got to charge in everyone at the same time because these levy spearmen, they break so fast, especially with the peasants. And I would use the peasants as like a flanking force, you know, try to go around the flanks of the enemy. If I was playing this scenario, I think I would let the Vikings come across right away. Because I feel like since, if you're commanding the English here, you have more troops, so you will be able to flank around more. So I would use my peasants to flank around, but since he was already fighting at that choke point, some of his troops here are pretty damn depleted and very tired. So they could instantly break as soon as they charge. But look at this, guys. It's just like the freaking battle. They're about to go in. Don't worry. We will slow it down once they're about to charge. Byrhtnoth's trying to let his men rest up a little bit before they engage. Here we go, guys. Here we go. The men are charging forward. They are marching. And this is it. It's all going to come down to this. Whoever wins this battle. As you look at the time, it is almost over. There's not much left of this battle, so whoever wins this final charge will take the victory here. Will Anglo-Saxon protect their gold, or will Vikings return home and become very, very rich men? Oh my god, here we go, they are colliding. This is too great, guys. Look at all the Anglo-Saxons charging in. There's a lot of them, but the Vikings are better fighters. That was a glorious charge. That was a long charge too. So here we go. Oh no, we have early breaking by the levy spears. But unlike the battle, Lord Byrhtnoth did not die almost instantly. And he's still fighting. The peasants are in the rear here, fighting as reserves. God, oh my god, the Viking raiders are cutting through them with ease. They are cutting through them with ease. And the general here, Olaf getting his axe wet, fighting off the comitatus. Where's the general? Here's Lord Byrhtnoth fighting his feudal knights, his comitatus fighting with them. They will die. They would love to die next to his presence. So he's kind of breaking on this side, but he's still holding on the other. Oh man. Oh, the peasants are breaking. That's no surprise there. No surprise there. That was a good battle. Good fight so far. Now, England needs to win on this flank, but it's not looking good. If you look at the balance of power, it's now greatly in favor of the Vikings. Come on, Lord Byrhtnoth. Fight! And he's still alive, which is good. There he is, not even bloodied up. He's like, come on, men! Hold! He's like, this is what I get for hiring a bunch of inexperienced laborers. Oh, he's running through the lines. Look, he's running through the front lines to inspire his troops. And the feudal knights here are holding the flank. Oh, and the arrows are... I would just use fire arrows to break the enemy. Oh, the English, this is their last hold right here. Lord Byrhtnoth's bodyguard protecting the flank against the dismounted Huscarls. Oh, and there goes Lord Byrhtnoth. Oh, no. Oh, no, that's not good. All right, wow. This battle almost played exactly how it happened in the real battle. And Lord Byrhtnoth has been slain. And now his troops break. Now his forces are going to break and come back, because that's just what peasants do. They break instantly and come back. So I don't think he can... I don't think he can rally his forces. And look at this. Look at this. The brave war band, even though they know the battle is over, they're going to continue to fight on because they honor their lord and they want to die with their lord as a brotherhood. They're actually trying to kill the general here. Olaf. Which I believe Olaf was known for spreading Christianity, I think. Like building the first church in Norway or maybe even England. But yeah, he was a Christian fellow, and he was king for like 5 years. So he didn't reign for long. There we go, destroying the comitatus. Now this guy breaks, but he'll get hit in the back. Flee for your life! And yeah, they're just running down the retreating forces. We've got a couple units still alive, but again, they're peasants and they're not going to do much. Charge in. One more huzzah. There we go. One more huzzah. Watch this epic fight between peasants and Viking raiders. And that's it, guys. That's over. That's as long as the fight happens there. And look what's left over here. He still has a ton of units here. So how do you think you would win the Battle of Maldon? Do you think you would just let him up right away and then just try to use your superior numbers to flank around his troops and cause fear because you're, you know, exposing the flanks and you're causing them to break because you're outmaneuvering them? Or would you continue to try to hold this choke point and let the reinforcements kind of flank around and you just kind of protect your flank? I mean, there's a couple possible ways you can do this, but Byrhtnoth, not doing so hot here, only getting 549 kills. Of course, this was Paladin Bob. He had a lot of troops. He had double the number of troops of the Viking Raiders, but it just wasn't enough. They were not experienced enough. Olaf here getting 1,528 kills. He would later march on, get paid off by the king, and I believe it was like, what, something Roman pounds, 10,000 Roman pounds, something like that. So guys, I hope you enjoyed this scenario. And of course, if you want to play this battle yourself, there's links in the description. You can download it, put it into your files. You can play it on multiplayer and single player. It is a 1v1 custom scenario. And if you have any critiques or criticism for my new historical series, let me know. I would love to hear how I can improve these videos. Thank you so much for watching, guys. Real quick, let's look at the results here. Real fast, who did the best? 66 by the armored sergeants. They did better than the feudal knights over here. So I think that's going to be the highest. Yeah, 66 armored sergeants. Cool. Very awesome. Did not expect that. So one more time, guys, thank you so much for watching. I hope you enjoyed, and I'll see you next time.